At the start of the 90s, U2's future was a blank slate. For the first time, the band was at a loss for what to do next. Bono said they should tap into the energy of the new Europe. The Cold War was over and the Berlin Wall was coming down. Bono thought it was time for them to make new music for a new era. U2 flew into East Berlin on the last flight before East Germany faded into history. They set up camp at Hansa Studios, the site of David Bowie's groundbreaking work with Brian Eno in the 70s. Bono figured that U2 would be inspired by the spirit of the place and the fervor of reunification. It was a good theory, but in reality, Hansa Studios was falling apart, and the band ended up staying in a sleazy hotel in the former East Berlin. But the biggest problem U2 faced was a division that almost broke up the group. Edge had been getting into a lot of experimental electronic music, and Bono was raving about dance rhythms at the Manchester club scene.
Going into that record, Bono and I had worked on maybe two or three songs that we thought were really special, that could go all the way. And it was a bit of a departure for the band. So there was this thing of, well, Bono and Edge are writing songs. They say they're great. They're taking us off in some different direction. And really, I felt Adam and Larry's resistance.
There was a lot of confusion, though I think everyone was suffering from it. It was this feeling that we had to forge a new sound for the band, but none of us really knew how to do that.
It was the first time ever that U2 would come together as a band and play and nothing would happen.
As the darkness of winter closed in on Berlin, the sessions dragged on and the band felt like they weren't getting anywhere. Edge started talking about splitting up the group. Larry felt that if they had to choose between the band and their friendships, U2 would have to go.
It had got pretty grim in Berlin.
There was a lot of shouting and, you know, people threatening to kill each other.
I could see the headlines, you know. The term musical differences, you know, starts to loom. And I thought, oh, this could get messy.
And then, out of the blue, popped this song One.
I just remember walking into the control room and hearing this guitar riff. It's the guitar riff from One. And I just said, that is it. This is something special. Is it getting
better? And within like 20 minutes, we were playing this thing and everyone was getting off on it. And that was the real turning point, I think, for me on the record, because I really felt that there was something very special in that tune.
We're one, but we're not the same. We get to carry each other, carry each other.
Whoa. That just felt right. I mean, maybe it summed up the way we felt as a band, trying to kind of go somewhere and not being able to at the time.
Once they realized they could still make music together, U2 was ready to go home. Back in Dublin, Bono, Larry, Adam, and The Edge had a serious discussion about their expectations of each other and the band. They listened to the tapes from Berlin and realized that they had a lot of good material to work with.
The whole session kind of turned around from then on, and everyone was much more focused and enthusiastic, and it kind of dispelled that tension. And then Adam and Larry started to get inspired, and then they came up with some great stuff, and we were off.
Octung Baby broke the U2 mold. Unlike the down-to-earth optimism of their earlier work, this record was dark and spacey, and you could dance to it. Octung Baby was released in November of 91 to universal acclaim and worldwide success. Now U2 had to figure out a way to take this music on the road.
Welcome to TV, y'all. The latest and greatest in software, hardware, and menswear. Let's hope this works. Let's see what we got on TV.
We will rock you.
For the Zoo TV tour, U2 put together a mixed media barrage complete with exploding cannons, costume changes, and a belly dancer. Bono adopted the stage character of The Fly, a megalomaniacal rock star.
You know, I had Jim Morrison's pants on, Lou Reed's shades, Elvis's jacket. I mean, it was like a dentikit pop star, you know. Just going for it, you know, full tilt. And that's what Zoo TV was. It was like we were getting killed in the media. So we decided to have fun with that. So out came the goggles. Well, I've been wearing them ever since.
Inspired by CNN's 24-hour-a-day coverage of the Gulf War, Zoo TV's 36 video screens beamed a shower of brilliantly edited images of pop culture and cruise missiles. Bono would make crank calls from the stage to order 10,000 pizzas, call a cab, or dial up the White House to try and get President Bush on the phone.
I'd like to speak to the President if I could.
He's not available to call.
It was a spectacle of tastelessness and excess and a grand parody of pop star narcissism. But it was funny, and a welcome break from the band's old holier-than-thou image. Demand for tickets outweighed supply 10 to 1. In August of 1992, U2 made a guest appearance on Rockline, a national phone-in radio show. They got a call from the media-savvy presidential candidate, Bill Clinton.
Should we call you Governor or Bill?
No, you call me Bill.
All right, and you can call me Betty.
Understand I have nothing against U2. You may not know this, but they try to call me at the White House every night during the concert. But the next time we face a foreign policy crisis, I will work with John Major and Boris Yeltsin, and Bill Clinton can consult Boy George.
The European leg of the tour commenced in May of 1993. Bono adopted a new stage persona for the European crowds. He became Mephisto, the devil in the form of a tired old pop star. He was the fly after he got fat and old and was playing Las Vegas. Mephisto mocked rock superstars, including Bono himself. He loved playing the role. Manager Paul McGinnis entered into contract renegotiations with Island Records. U2 was in a position of power. They were the most popular rock band in the world, and they had sold 50 million records for Island. The label was not about to lose their crown jewel. They offered U2 a $70 million deal for the next six records. It was the financial coup that the band would need. The Zoo TV tour was such a giant undertaking that the cost of putting the show on the road ate up the proceeds. Without corporate sponsorship, the band paid for the tour themselves. And U2's commitment to keeping ticket prices low for their fans resulted in only small profits. In Australia, toward the end of the tour, Adam went out partying and missed a gig. That had never happened before. The band drafted Adam's bass roadie and played the show without him. Afterward, Adam had to confront the fact that his rock and roll lifestyle had begun to threaten his relationship with the band. By the time the tour ended 3 weeks later, Adam was clean and sober. He had almost drifted away from the group, but his friends would not let him go. Meanwhile, Edge had fallen in love with Morley Steinberg. Morley was a choreographer who had joined the last leg of the tour as the belly dancer who came on stage to tempt Bono during Mysterious Ways.
It was a funny thing. It wasn't really until we were around each other a lot that we got a chance to really get to know one another. And now we have our baby Cyan, who's like nearly a year old, and we're still much in love.
At the end of 1993, Bono, Edge, Adam, and Larry went back to Dublin after nearly 2 years of touring. They had accomplished what many would have thought impossible. They had completely changed U2's sound and image while maintaining their enormous popularity. In the process, they managed to go from being the hottest band of the 80s to the coolest band of the 90s. Everyone wondered what they would do next. The second half of the 90s would give U2 some of their proudest moments, as well as their biggest failure.